Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. I'm Tennessee Fats, and today I'm doing a Conan miniseries review. Now the series I'm going to be talking about today is a fairly obscure one. Way back in 97, 98, in what I'm going to call, the doldrum years for Marvel Comics. Let's call it the doldrum years. I think that's probably a fairly appropriate phrase to apply here. And for those of you who are Marvelites, you're probably not going to give me too hard of a time on that particular statement. This is a particular Conan series that Marvel put out during the doldrum years, and it's called this. Conan the Usurper. It was 3 issues, as you can see here, and I just finished reading it. And I says to myself, Tennessee Fats, you don't often spend a lot of time doing the reviews of the actual series. Maybe you should just put this one out there as a PSA. So I am. So what we're going to do today is I'm going to walk you guys through the series, and for spoiler alert, okay, for those of you who are saying to yourselves, I want to read this, Tennessee Fats, don't ruin it for me, stop watching now. Okay, for those of you who are saying to yourself, I'm probably never going to buy this, but I am interested in finding out what's going on, well, I'm glad you stuck around, because what we're going to do is we're going to go through this, not page by page, but we're going to go through the content here, and I'm going to give you a sense of what we're looking at as we're going through this. And at the end of this, I'm going to tell you, should you buy this, or should you not? Let's go with that. And we're back. Now, as per usual at this point in time of the video, this is where I do the obligatory YouTubing. If you like Robert E. Howard content and you like the content of this particular video, give this one a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel down there or there. I don't know. Do that whole thing there. And by all means, if you're out there and you're saying to yourself, hey, self, I got something to say about this. Tennessee Fats, you're either bang on or, you know, you're full. Feel free to make a little comment down there below. I am actually really getting a kick out of it and really enjoying reading those comments and then commenting back, because I do actually try to respond to them as quick as I can. Anyways, that's the obligatory YouTube stuff out of the way. Let's keep this quick today. Let's just start looking at what we got here. So this is the series we're talking about here. I got them all out of the bags and the boards here because we're going to be reading them, and let's just face facts. These ain't no million-dollar books. Let's get to the point, shall we? All right, so issue one. Now, Conan the Usurper. So a bit of history here for those of you who don't know. I did a little bit of the Googling in this one, and Conan the Usurper, I guess, was the title of a collection of some of the Robert E. Howard and L. Sprague de Camp stories about Conan. Not entirely sure where that title comes from. I'll be honest about that one. Not entirely sure. Because I haven't read that particular collection of short stories. It could be the actual truncated stories that lead up to Conan then becoming a king. I imagine that's probably the case given the title. Usurper, a usurper to the throne. You don't generally say to yourself, hey, you know what, I'm a usurper to my job serving coffee at Tim Hortons. No, you didn't kill somebody to take over that job. You got hired for it. So generally usurp a throne. Well, you could also usurp authority. And listen, that's not the point of today's video. Let's just get down to the actual book itself. So 1997, and I earlier referred to this as the doldrum years for Marvel. And the reason why I call it doldrum years for Marvel is because they were putting out a let's face it, they were not putting out the original Conan and the Barbarian series. That was done. And done a long time ago. The magazines, they dwindled out. They were done. So you ended up having Marvel putting out these sort of mini-series from time to time. There was Conan the Usurper, for example. There was Conan, was it Return of the Spider God, I think is another one. Fiends and Flame. I don't know. They were just throwing random words in there. At most times, it seemed like it was actually Conan Purple Monkey Microphone at times. I don't know what they were going for, but, you know, bottom line was they were putting out these miniseries. And they did this on them, and this is a common theme that you notice. Is you open her on up here, and you get this little thing, a foldy-outy doodly here at the front. And it walks through, well, here's what's happened so far, here's our cast of characters, and here's you know, Conan over here. And I'm gonna leave this one right here, so that we can just take a moment and just, let's read this together, shall we? Born in a time of swords and sorcery, the Sumerian known as Conan battles the forces of evil in a valiant effort to right the wrongs of his world. Using his brains as well as his brawn, he fights the good fight as Conan the Barbarian. Now, what? I'm sorry, what? Like, honestly, this depiction of Beavis and Butthead, I think, is a more honest depiction of them as opposed to Conan. This is probably actually closer to Conan than actually is what I just read there. That's very much sort of a Conan the Adventurer type cartoon. Great cartoon by its own right. Not necessarily the Conan that was in print. Anyways, story starts off with Conan in a bar. This panel is somewhat cringeworthy in and of itself. I'm not going to go into why it's cringeworthy. If you want, you can, you can freeze the frame there and you can read the dialogue and you go, oh, gee, yeah, oh, ah, ooh. And you'll say, wow, I can understand why that's somewhat cringeworthy. Conan gets himself into a bar fight. He is hired on as a mercenary at this point in time. Gets himself in a bar fight with some regular soldiers. And he's part of an outland platoon or an outlander platoon. So these are basically hired mercenaries that are working with this army. Now, this is a common theme, and it's right off the bat in your first panels here. And let's just take a look here at these particular people. I don't know. And I'm going to wait until we get a little bit further into this one before we go, I'm sorry, what? Because these are supposed to be Aquilonian soldiers, okay? These soldiers, however, seem to look a little different. Anyways, Conan gets into a fight, beats the tar out of a bunch of them, and they end up just basically hammering the guy to basically into unconsciousness with the brunts of their spears. Why they wouldn't have just killed him with like the pointy end of their spears, I'm not entirely sure. But end of the day, they leave him drunk and out in the street and knocked out because they beat the crap out of him with spears. And then this happens. Now, the last time I checked, the Roman Empire was not around 10,000 years ago. Now, you know, I'm sure there are people out there that are Roman Empire-ophiles, and they're going to scream and go, oh, no, the Roman Empire is forever. No, it's not. It's not, actually. We know when the start of the Roman Empire was, chronologically, and we know what the end of it was. That's another funny thing. There's a giant multi-volumed hardcover book series you can go out there and called The Rise and Fall of the Roman Empire, which will walk you through the whole thing. But yet here we have basically Rome, him on the streets with a Roman general saying, no, this guy's good. He just took out 12 of your guys before you guys managed to knock him out. So, you know, put him up there with the spearmen because he's better off being cannon fodder than our own domestic troops. And you're like, all right. Okay, so now we're talking Romans. I don't know about any Romans that hung around in the Hyborian Age, but whatever. And Conan's in here, and he steps to the next panel. He's yakking with his friends as they're heading out to this big battle that they're heading out to. You don't really know where this battle is that they're heading out to, but they're going there anyways. And the idea is, we're going out because we are going to defend the Aquilonian border. And he's yammering on saying, you know, I'm going to be a king, and his friends just sort of laugh at him, and he scowls at them. And then you cut scene, and here's our Roman general looking down, at this particular fort. And the outlanders are the ones that are going to be out front while they're peppering it with arrows. These guys are going to breach the wall and go into the fort. And these are Vanir men. Okay, so for you Conanophiles out there, you know who the Vanir are. You know what's going on here. And Conan's sacking this particular fort. And they're saying, oh, you know, these guys have been squatting on our territory. So we're just going to, you know, take this fort down and get them the heck out of here. And, you know, that's what we're doing. Now, this is a part where I think we get a little bit of Conan chronology confusion. Because here, suddenly, Conan is the first person in, charging along, saying, yes, let's go murder everybody. Which, I don't know, this seems like it's a throwback or some sort of commentary back to Conan's, well, the original Conan story, of when he was the first over the wall, was it Venarium, I think was the name of it, when the Sumerians attacked and slaughtered them all. And I'm going, well, is that actually what's happening here, or is that not what's happening here? I don't know. Because it's all sort of confusing, because we've got Romans now, and they're fighting the Vanir. That doesn't make sense. And, of course, the general says, no, you guys can just keep throwing arrows in there, because I don't care about these outlander soldiers. And Conan's fighting with an axe and a hammer. One end of the hammer has a pointy end. Well, that's rather clever. Kind of neat. Fighting, doing all the thing, slashing people, and, you know, this person comes up and sporks him with a spear. And somehow he managed to survive that, but, you know, knocks them out and finds out, what the poop, it's a woman. But then they win, and the general comes in and says, okay, everything's fine. And this is where we start to get some weirdness, okay? It's weird, okay? This whole scene here of throwing down my sword, you know, you bested us with numbers, yada yada. My sword is yours, and all the shame of my tribe is mine. And you got a Roman general, and he's throwing down his sword to him, and I'm like, okay, hold on. Now, this is where the old man brain of Tennessee Fats kicks in and goes, wait a minute, is this a Gaul? Is this Caesar? Is this a Gaul? Is this him throwing down a sword because Caesar just conquered Gaul? What the? So you're left with that sort of, I don't know, that illusion within the story. And then Conan comes out of nowhere to the general, even though he's just a worthless nothing at that point in time, and says, whoa, I want to have some words with you. And he says, you owe me a boon because, you know, I did really well in the battle, and I want her as a spear maiden. And the general just says, yeah, okay, that's fine. Because he just doesn't care. Everybody else is going to be crucified on the way back to the capital. Very Roman. Rome. I don't know. Anyways, he takes her back, throws her in the ground, and he's basically, why he has his own tent, I don't understand. Because generally they would be sharing at this point in time. And also, yeah, I will point this out, as far as historical battles go, and 2 points to them for this one, you'll notice around this hill fort, that they were looking down at, by the way, looking down at the hill fort. You can piece between what I'm saying right there. There's a ditch. There's actually a nice ditch. So 2 points on that. That was historically accurate, but why does he have his own tent? He's just a general soldier. Anyways, she's like, you're not going to ravish me? And he's like, no, I need a spear woman. I'll go to sleep. Here's everybody being crucified on the way back. Conan's walking back with his spear woman, and his friends are making fun of him. Like, oh, look at all the loot we got, and you just got, you know, a slave. I don't know. To me, economically, the slave would be the better buy. But, you know, slavery's wrong. Just going to throw that out there. Anyways, we're back home. And whoa. Why are we looking at the Romans again? I don't understand. I don't entirely grasp what's going on here. So here's basically Julius Caesar coming home to an emperor. The Roman Empire at the time didn't have an emperor, had a Senate. So maybe that's different, and that doesn't quite match. But okay, but anyways, we got some sort of weird mix of Roman and what have you. And he's like, oh yeah, I did a great job. He's like, yeah, you did a great job. And by the way, I'm going to have your name stamped onto a coin. Well, that's very Roman. Oh, by the way, I need you to go out and kill some more people for me, because these are my northern kingdoms, and or the kingdoms north of us. And I think what we should do is just go slaughter them all and subjugate them. And then we'll be richer, because we'll have all their wealth and their slaves. And then we'll just go and attack everything to the south. And here's, I guess, the equivalent of Julius Caesar in the story, saying, oh, where would you have me wage war against first? And, oh, we've just found out we're going to go march on Samaria. And here's his spear woman laughing. And that's the end of the book. You're like, okay, all right. So this book, I don't know. As a standalone story, there was some confusion in it. Him being the first over that wall just sort of made me throw back to, well, hold on, what actually are we talking about here? And then, of course, the inclusion of the Romans, which I guess was a dead giveaway on the cover. I should have seen it coming. Quite confusing. I didn't. And why is he fighting Romans on the cover? He wasn't. Anyways, let's put that aside. So let's get back to this now. So interestingly, you know, I mentioned earlier that you get this funny little thing at the front where they give you a highlight of here's what happened last in our last episode. Well, there's our story about Conan once again being some sort of a barbarian superhero. And time has passed. And suddenly we have a rewrite of what actually happened in issue one. And where are we over here? Let's just get down here. The Emperor Aquilonia was pleased with his conquest, but Vindictus warned him of Conan's growing popularity with the troops. The Emperor brushed aside these concerns and ordered Vindictus to make ready for a new campaign. The target? Samaria, Conan's homeland. Well, hold on. I just read that. None of that whole, oh, Conan's getting too popular stuff was anywhere in the story. This was all bang on, but now we're rewriting an issue that was literally only a month earlier. That's where my face did a little bit of this. Right. So anyways, let's get into this one. Time has obviously passed here. Conan is now making his way into Samaria. They've sacked a Sumerian village. Conan's okay with this. Yeah, the silence should fill in that for you. This does not have a ditch around it. That doesn't seem to make sense to me. Not entirely there, but again, Romans, you know, hang out. And this would actually be pretty cold. You got snow on the ground, and these guys are literally wearing metal bangles and stuff. And anyways, Conan's like, oh yeah, I'm okay with this because, you know, war is war and people die in war. And he wanders off, and of course, his spear woman makes a snooty comment of, oh, you're okay with, you know, working with these guys and slaughtering your own people. And she's like, yeah, just keep your tongue. And off he goes, and as they're heading further in, he's, I guess, becoming more. What would be the word I would use here? He's becoming more amorous with the idea of the Sumerians that are actually fighting. He's actually appreciating that what they're doing. And he's pointing out, no, guys, these are the tactics that I was taught as a Sumerian child, like when I was a kid. Why do you guys not know these? And he's basically being very clear. He's saying, you know, the Sumerians are going to make you pay for any progress you make into this land with blood. And he's right. They do. And he's also making comments with regards to they're going to use the dark. They're going to use the land against you. And they're going to just instill terror, basically almost like guerrilla tactics. And he's kind of happy about this. And you're like, okay, well, maybe he's not so cool with slaughtering his own people, which totally would not match the character of Conan. just, and this is where my face is now starting to go, whoa. And it goes to one of these. Because you see, Conan never in his right mind would be going, yeah, let's go slaughter Sumerians. That just would not happen. Now, the fact that he was okay with it at the beginning of the story, that just doesn't make any sense to me. The fact that he's sort of turning now and he's sort of like, well, you know, maybe I'm kind of okay with the Sumerians, you know, fighting back. Well, no, he wouldn't have been that way at all. Either it would have been 100% of, no, let's kill everything in front of me. Or it would have been of, no, we're not going to kill Sumerians. What the hell are you, crazy? But I don't know. Something in this just, it makes you go, what? And of course, now the spear woman comes in and of course they're going to sleep together. Not entirely grasping that. Now here you have another part of this where a Roman soldier is coming over and says, oh, by the way, just in case you're curious, the men would probably go with you if you wanted to rebel. And time again passes. You're now camped over for the winter and they're running out of food. And Julius Caesar over here, or Julius Caesar-esque dude, decides that they're going to slaughter all of the women and children that they were holding hostage. These are the family members of the local chieftains, so that they would be able to actually get safe passage. He decides, I'm going to slaughter them. Now, whoa. Let's just... So this is where I stop, and I'm gonna take some coffee here and just go, yes, well. He goes, we need to calm down here. Because now, you can't make this any more clearly an allegory back to Julius Caesar. You honestly can't. You're talking, he's now going to slaughter women and children. Now, for those of you who don't know much about Julius Caesar, in the conquest of Gaul, I believe the year was 52 BC, was when he had surrounded a hill fort. A hill fort, by the way, is on the tallest hill in the area, so you don't look down on them. Anyway, he decided to surround one of these, because he said, the only way I'm going to take this is by siege. I'm just going to starve them out. And he basically had a whole whack of all the rebel Gauls against him up there with their families. And he built a bunch of ditches around it, and he built a wall around it so they couldn't get in or out. Supplies couldn't get to them. And at that point in time, the Gauls who were in there said, well, you know what, we're going to send our women and children out. Because they're eating all of our resources and they need to be safe. And although it is going to, we're going to have them go out and basically offer their lives as slaves in exchange for food, unconditionally surrendering them, which must have been a horrible choice for these poor Gauls to make. They did that. And of course, Caesar in his infinite wisdom said, no, I'm just gonna let you starve to death. So the poor Gauls who are sitting up at the top of this hill fort are watching their family members and their children and wives in the area between the two forts basically starve to death over time, while the Roman soldiers on the outside, who are already short of supplies to begin with, are also watching this happen. And Caesar's just sort of sitting there going, yeah, well, you know, things happen. Probably one of the darker points in the history of Julius Caesar. There are other dark points as well, but there's no point in getting to that now. But this is where you're like, hold on, you're going to kill women and children because you're low on food and you don't want to kill your stable horses. And you're like, what? You can't be more Caesar than this. This does not compute. Anyways, Conan comes along, and I guess this is the point in time when he decides, okay, I've now had enough of this. Even though he's been slaughtering Sumerians all along, this, I guess, is the tricking point where he says, no, you know what we're going to do? I'm going to kill everybody that wants to kill Sumerian women and children. He lets the Sumerian women and children go, basically has his outlaw team go behind him, his outlaw cohort. The Romans, who are with him, actually stand with him, and those who are loyal to, obviously, Julius Caesar over here, who has his own secured parapet inside the fort, doesn't make any sense, says, no, you're not going to take me. Now, here, they're, you know, arguing, and this is where an archer would just kill him, and that would be the end of it. But no, instead, they have this big thing where they have to have it out. There's lots of talking, and of course, the soldiers go over to Conan, and he's getting a little concerned. And then he's like, no, I'm going to take my remaining troops who are here with me, and we're just going to die by fighting to the death with you guys. And, of course, his right-hand man gets shanked. And Conan says, well, no, you were going to kill Sumerian women and children, so I'm just going to let them kill you. And then he rides off south because he's decided he's going to go kill the king of Aquilonia. So this is where I'm stepping back. I was like, okay, so hold on. So basically you're telling me this is the story of how Conan now is going to go and become the king. Interesting. It fits the title, Usurper. But how is that what happened? Book two, done. Book three. Okay. So, to the last. All right, so let's get the whole little story here. This story doesn't rewrite anything. It actually matches what happened in the second book. And you're like, oh, okay, so there's continuity here. That's good. That's a positive thing. And Conan is riding south to the capital. And as he goes along the way, effectively this issue is essentially just Conan riding through the countryside, slaughtering, well, who he has to, recruiting the generals who survive and surrender to him to his own side, while the emperor over here just sort of ignores the whole thing. They continue to head south. They do a clever ploy where they tie sticks to horses and mules to create a dust cloud to lead the defenses away while they walk around them, which they do. Conan fights with his brain, not just with his sword, which is a comment that a general clearly makes in here while they're teaching him. And then he goes and lays siege to the capital and breaks in. Obviously, he's burnt the way, scorched earth sort of policy so that nobody can follow him along the way. And let's get to the point. Like, you know it's coming. He gets inside. One of his friends that was in the outlaw platoon or outlaw group with him is killed by a rock, by a child. And you're like, what the hell? Anyways. Oh, no, where was the other one? It's in here, I think. Yeah, his other friend who, you know, was always sort of guffawing at him gets shot with an arrow. Because, you know what you do in a battle when you're fighting and there's archers all over the place is you stand really still and have a conversation. I don't know if you knew that, but that's totally what you do in a battle. It's especially when you have a shield on your arm. You just stand still and have a conversation so an arrow can shoot you in the throat. Anyways, they get to the actual throne room where the emperor is, and Conan's spearwoman says, no, I'm going to kill you for the blood of my own people. And for some reason, she just stands still and lets him kill her. Conan then kills what we'll call the emperor, and then says, oh, I never even knew your name. And at the end, you have this whole thing about how he now becomes the king, and he now doesn't doubt any of the soothsayers that spoke with him, and he never knew another easy night and joyful day. And that's the end of it. Like that, and I gotta tell you, I read that, and that's when my face did this. And I gotta tell you, I'm generally pretty positive on my Conan stuff. I generally like my Conan. I'm good with the Conan. I'm good with the Robert E. Howard. This one just, like what? Now, this was written by Chuck Dixon, okay? Now, Chuck Dixon did a lot of stuff and still does a lot of stuff. He's a prolific writer. Wrote a lot of Punisher, wrote a lot of the Batman stuff, did a lot of stuff with, was it CrossGen, I think, was it another company he went with? And his stuff has typically been good. So I have a sense in this, especially when you had that rewrite of basically the narrative between issue 1 and 2, something went wrong here. I suspect, and I may be wrong, and you know what, if anybody over at Marvel Comics wants to pick up the phone and call me and discuss this with me, I'd be more than happy to shoot a follow-up video to this one and tell me what the hell happened here. You have a great character. You have a story where he becomes a king, and for some reason, I think somebody was trying to use some revisionist history here to rewrite the canon of how he got there. This story was so inconsistent with the original material. There's actually a project out there. It's a website. You can go look it up. It's called the Marvel Continuity Project. And this has been excluded from it. Now, I don't know how many things would get excluded from a continuity project, but you know, when your miniseries of 3 issues has a rewrite of the narrative between 1 and 2, and then it's completely kiboshed from history by effectively a fan group that's saying, no, you're gone. That tells you something is not right here. I don't know what happened here. If you read this, And you were a non-Conanophile, you just read this as the only Conan book you're ever going to read in your entire life, you would go, okay, well, yeah, that's not bad. You know what? It's short and it's sweet. And, you know, it's got all sorts of, it's got Romans. People love to see Romans on the screen. Why don't we make a movie out of this? That would, to me, make sense. And Hollywood would pick this up. Boom, boom. This would be on the big screen. And would you get Kevin Sorbo? Maybe you'd get Kevin Sorbo. No. Because you know what you do now. You'd pay The Rock to wear a wig and do this. Because you know what? It's a self-contained story. It would work. You just need big flair to it. The Rock is big flair all the time. The dude's huge. And then this would go really well. But if you're a Conanophile, if you know anything about the character, you'd read this and you go, what the hell? Huh. So conclusion time. Let's step back here. I've given you my thoughts here. I've given you several views of my face as it went from, okay, I'm kind of interested, is down to, what? And now we got to get to, should you buy this and should you read this? Well, I bought this because I'm a Conanophile. I bought this because I wanted to see how the doldrum years at Marvel were for Conan. And I wanted to see how they were treating him through these miniseries. I never read these when these came out. I completely ignored these because I did. I just went, move on. I had other things to do with my life. Well, now I've gone back and I bought them because I guess this is just a point where I'm looking back and I'm saying, well, how did that happen? What did happen there and how did these go? And I've thumbed through some of these other stories. I've thumbed through some of the other miniseries and they're not bad. So what happened here? Personally, I think this was a project that started with some impetus, started with some favor, and then lost it really, really quickly. And somebody up in the editorial team at Marvel said, you got to wrap this thing up and get it the hell out of here. You got to get Conan to the point where he's a king at the end of the day, and c'est ça. Huh. And I got to tell you, that is not how to treat a complex character like Conan. Honestly, look at the guy. Let's take a moment and look at him here. Do you not think he deserves more than this? I do. Anyways, you don't want to buy this. This is something, if you see this out there when you're digging around and you see it in the dollar bins, or if you even see it in a comic rack where somebody's charging anything more than a dollar for it, you just walk away from it. If you see it for a dollar, walk away from it. I don't think you're going to miss much in this, unless you're somebody out there just says to yourself, I just want a 1-3-issue story that gives me a story of a guy that goes from being a little mercenary warrior dude up to a king and kills lots of Romans along the way. If that's what you're looking for, you're going to love this. If that's not exactly what you're looking for, don't. Just don't. Well, everybody, that's all I got to say on this one. I could keep going, but it's beating a dead horse. I don't see any point in doing it. We will see you in the next one. I hope you have yourself a great day. Thanks for sticking through us.